A little
हाँ
more travel, a little less a day.
Can you see the first slide?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So Prajesh, we're waiting for you.
He already said start.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay, everyone. Good morning, good evening from to all of you from different parts of the world. Thank you very much for joining this session. My name is Sharath Hegde and I am the host for this show. Today we are going to talk about how to be positive and productive in our work environment. And we have with us two eminent speakers whom I would like to introduce. The first one is Pramod Sadar Joshi. And Pramod is the founder and CEO of Talent Smith. He's an excellent public speaker. He's worked as a human capital management expert, and he's worked with several leading IT companies, large ones with lakhs of employees, in fact. And he has spearheaded a lot of leadership interventions on technology as well as wellness. And he has been a huge proponent of how to be able to maintain this balance in this highly stressful environment. And I would like to welcome Pramod.
Thank you, Sharad. Pleasure being here. And thanks for inviting. Look forward.
Our next speaker is Ravi Venkateshan. And Ravi is based in Atlanta. Thank you for joining, Ravi, from overseas. And Ravi is actually hugely into technology and innovation. He has been a speaker in multiple sessions, which train people in how to speak, how to present oneself. And he's a fairly very popular speaker in the technology world. Welcome, Ravi.
Thank you, Sharad. Great to be here. I'm excited about this webinar and looking forward to the conversation.
Yeah, thank you. So today is just to introduce the topic today. We have been in this. All of us know about the current crisis in the world, and in this crisis, people are losing jobs. People are having difficulty surviving in the business environment. So it affects people as individuals, as professionals, being able to contribute and to our work, as well as for businesses which are kind of struggling to be able to find a way to stay above the board and make profit in this current situation, as well as to be able to innovate. So there's a need to be able to look for different avenues to be able to and different ways by which they can do business. So in this context, I think in these challenging times, I think it's very important to get your perspectives into how businesses can be run, and from multiple angles. So we thought we would share and exchange some dialogue with you. We want this to be very personal and engaging. So please feel free to quote from whatever is your experience dealing with customers, as individuals, teams, and we will try and keep this engaging and participative. So let me try and get some perspectives first from Pramod. Pramod, if you could just talk about how each of us as individuals have to remain positive, productive, how can we kind of keep in touch? You know, it's so important just to have a conversation really with an individual. And what do you see are the impediments which you think need to be addressed?
Right. Thank you, Sharad. I think you really put things in perspective and laid the context. I think if there was ever a time where man's prowess, both mental toughness as well as ability to weave a team together, got tested, the litmus test, as they say, it is now. Because stakes are high, chips are down, and globally, it's a hugely challenging time. It's literally mayhem out there. But as this very famous quote, I don't know whose author, who says, a man's reach should exceed his grasp, or what's a heaven for? I think it's an amazingly motivating statement. So in these times is when four aspects of each one of us is really getting tested. And I think we need to be prepared on all the four fronts. Very simple: body, mind, heart, and soul. This is a time where you're locked down at home. So regular rigor of a gym is gone. And why body needs to be in perfect shape for you to belt out that amazing cerebral prowess. You need an amazingly fit engine, as they say, to execute. And therefore, it calls whether it's pranayama, excuse me, yoga, your own Surya Namaskara, what have you. I think getting that discipline of and rigor of keeping your body very fit is prime. As they say, body and mind are ill or well together. A wonderful statement. So I start with, and it's a challenge because the regular, as I said, schedule of your walks, etc., is getting disturbed. I can't even go for a walk outside. There are cops there and they're asking questions. But then how do you keep that? There are lots of yoga and yoga techniques which you can do there. So you need to be executing body machine very well. We move to the second part to stay motivated and positive. This guy, you know, everything between the 2 years is really getting tested. I mean, if you thought you had a great willpower, if you thought you had a great resilience of sorts, welcome to the big game. Because what are the challenges? You do not have an office where a lot of systemic ambience is already there. The ecosystem is there. You need to create a carve out of space within your home or wherever, so that the disturbances are minimum. But the most important thing is, how do you keep your mind completely tuned in, configured sort of to address the challenges? Because, and especially if you're in a leadership role like you or Ravi, it's very important because people are looking at you. And your body language is a huge giveaway when you come on a con call or a webinar. So how do you really bring the clarity of mind, extremely devoid of any agitational thoughts, frustration, or any kind of negativity of sorts, or despair? I think that's where you get tested. And we'll talk a little bit about how do you really clean up the mind so that you remain completely focused. The third component is heart. As I say, heart is the seat of the soul. And whether it's a great news, happy news, or bad news, it all affects the heart here. And how do you keep this heart really a fountainhead, a springboard, if you will, of extremely positive emotions, so that whenever and wherever people interact with you, you come across as somebody who's in the moment, in the present, and that's where bringing that heartfulness, if I may use the word, is very, very critical. And the last part is, I mean, if you're not spiritually, when I say spiritually, not in a very orthodox sense, but if, as I say, enthusiasm is all about high spirits, if that doesn't go through, I think there is a lot of work which needs to do. So four things, if they are sort of coming in unison, mind, body, heart, and soul, I think it requires a lot of effort. There are tools to do that. The second thing was, what are the impediments? I think the first thing is, when you walk into an office building, there is a default discipline system, if you will, whether it's your biometric sensor or this place you sit, the reporting system, they're not there now. So it brings a huge, huge challenge for you to be extremely self-disciplined. Tune yourself to say that there's nobody watching over me, but there are people dependent on me for clarity, for directions, for support. And therefore, getting that disciplined mindset is a challenge because, as you know, due to lockdown, there are a lot of domestic chores which I now need to handle. Until yesterday, until this coronavirus came in, you just walked away to office, the maid servants and domestic help came and did everything. Now you do need to do the vacuuming and the washing and what have you. But yet, so therefore it brings a lot of focus also on the second challenge, which is managing time very well. Extremely important, which again is an offshoot of the first thing, which is discipline. And the third thing, Sharath, is people are looking up to you, especially if you're a leader. Your clarity of thought, your emotive state, your ability to deal with ambiguous situation. I know VUCA is now a very used word, but the kind of volatility is there is in business, whether it's a large enterprise or an MSME or a small startup. It's huge. The whole uncertainty part of it, the complexity and the whole ambiguity. And that's where I thought one should really bring about a total persona to the process. So there is no ecosystem. First impediment, you need to create that ecosystem. A mental discipline. Most important, you do not get recognition reward immediately in this kind of setup. As against when you're in an office, you did a great deal, there's a little get together or a brown bag, if you will, and there's a good high five and all that's happening. Here you're all alone, and therefore to stay intrinsically motivated calls for an immense preparation, both from a technical prowess point of view, from an emotive point of view, and also from an extremely balanced sense of mind. And this is all easier said than done. But as we go through the session, through your inputs and Ravi's input, we'll see how it can be managed. As I said, this is the time where you come to the party. There's a lovely quote which I want to say. A diamond is nothing but a charcoal which handles stress just a little better. I repeat, a diamond is nothing but a charcoal which handles stress just a little better. The other day I was listening to Professor Adizes. He says this is a stress test of our lives. If we can come out of this pressure situation, all smiling and all guns blazing on top of the thing, you will convert yourself from a charcoal to a diamond. But the flip side is, if you give away the willpower, if you submit and resign to the situation in a fatalistic manner, then my question is, as the first quote, a man's reach should exceed his grasp. Come on, you need to pull yourself up, because this is your litmus test. And that's where you push the envelope and get ahead, leading your team by leading by personal example. This is just my opening thoughts about, I think, how we should go about it. And that's what I'm doing with my teams and my customers. They're all looking up to you. So you really need to rise to the occasion and come up as a role leader, a role model, and a leader by example. But just my opening thoughts.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you, Pramod. Yeah. So the next question I wanted to just touch upon was, you know, in terms of what skills should one develop in these times. Just to give a personal example, you know, being at home with the entire family, with the kids and all that, now they want me to learn how to cook. So I have been learning how to cook myself. And my daughter is my coach, and she kind of takes my cooking lesson. So,
reverse mentoring of sorts.
Yes, reverse mentoring is happening at this time. So, Ravi, I just wanted to ask you, what do you think is, what skills we should develop, you know, so that we can be productive, we can, you know, continue to grow and remain positive. So how do we kind of utilize this opportunity in that fashion? Technical, non-technical, whatever. I mean, you know, whatever you think can be done in these times.
Yeah, I think when we think about skills, there are a couple of broad categories, right? So it's always people talk about hard skills and soft skills. So in the current COVID-19 driven situation and with lockdowns everywhere, I think there are a set of hard skills that are needed, which are, you know, just get very used to technology, get very used to video meetings, web meetings, get used to conference calls, become very aware of how the dynamic of communication changes when you're in person versus when you're trying to do a video conference versus when you're trying to do a voice call. You know, I noticed so many cases where something as simple as people talking over each other happens a lot because they are not used to this medium. where it's not as easy to take the body language cues and pause and listen. So I think there's that. And then there is this set of skills around create a routine, absolutely indispensable in this kind of situation, right? Some people are by nature very disciplined, and some people like myself are by nature not very disciplined. But it worked because I used to have to get up and have to go to the office, and you know, things just fall in place. Now I'm, you know, in the first few days of this thing happening, I found myself waking up and straight away jumping onto the computer, straight away taking a conference call. And before you know it, it's noon and you haven't had that shower, you haven't dressed up. I would almost recommend forcing yourself to get into a routine in the morning, you know, take that shower, brush your teeth, basic stuff, you know, set up a separate desk or a nice space for yourself. Go sit there as if you're going to your office. That creates a lot of productivity. So now that's on the productivity side. Let's come to the positivity side, right? Positivity, in my viewpoint, comes from two sources. One is, of course, intrinsically how much at peace and how calm you are. And there are ways to get there. And the second thing which I'm noticing is affecting people a lot is their relationships. On the one side, relationships within the family are under, like Pramod said, a stress test. And that's because we are spending more time with each other, right? Husband and wives are getting on each other's nerves.
Ravi, you're tempting me to say familiarity breeds contempt.
Sorry, go ahead. So a friend of mine said, you know, there are going to be two types of booms that come out of COVID. There is going to be a baby boom and a divorce boom, both at the same time, right? So there is that side, and we need to be very aware of this, and we need to pay special attention to relationships that we take for granted. Yes, we have a tendency to take for granted the relationship with our spouses, the relationship with our children, with our brothers, sisters, parents, whoever is at home. So that's one side, to mend, to heal, to really pay attention, be alert, be aware. The other side, when it comes to the workplace, there are, and I learned this some time back, there are four key toxins to relationships that we have to be aware of: stonewalling, contempt, defensiveness, and criticism. So a simple tip is, in every interaction, every email you're sending, every conference call you're getting on, every phone call you're getting on, try to watch if you're falling into any of these traps. Are you stonewalling? Are you criticizing? Are you being contemptuous? Are you being defensive? If you can be alert, aware, and catch yourself and correct these things, relationships will blossom at the workplace. And I think relationships are the key to positivity. So that's my response to both the productivity and the positivity side.
Okay, thank you.
Sharad, if I may just add one point to Ravi, has triggered a thought, a wonderful point is what I love the 4 points he's brought about. You know, what happens in an email is email doesn't have a face and a body. Therefore, Ravi brings out a very important point about how you construct your sentence, what words you use. Because somebody is not seeing you in person, it can just damage and hurt. And as I said, those four sins can be committed. So you've got to be very savvy in terms of skill level to up your ante on using the medium very well and master it so that the impact is as good, if not better, when you're in person. Great thought.
Yeah. Thank you, Ravi. I think excellent. I think it's so important to be remain connected, you know, virtually connected, learn to be able to kind of work in this environment where we are not used to, where we are connected over the internet. You know, I think it's a skill by itself. So it's important to be able to build that. And I think I love this point about creating the routine and having a kind of a pattern. So we kind of get into that discipline. It kind of ties on to the aspect of discipline, which Pramod was talking about. You know, thank you very much for bringing that. I think relationships, they are under stress, and I think this is another very important point in how to be alert, aware about that. Thank you. So let's move on. So Pramod, now let's talk a little bit about the teams. You know, how do we, as the teams, we have to kind of projects have, you know, multiple people have to work together, right? So how do we kind of get this feeling that of being together and being collective and be able to motivate each other? So what problems do you see when you speak to your teams? You know, what are the things which you are seeing, and how do you think we can address some of these?
I think that's a very insightful question, because you're no more now in a place where you can just get into the hallway and get, or in a conference and get everybody there. So I would like to think of 3-4 things. One, extreme clarity on the goals to be achieved, because now there's a spurt in activity, spurt in tension, spurt in demand. So extreme clarity on what are goals for each individual. B, how do you break that goal into specific roles so that they're not overstepping each other? There's no negative competition, and there's also a fair allocation of duties, so nobody feels he's being overburdened at the cost of somebody's lesser targets and therefore. So the manager or the leader who's driving stuff has got to be extremely clear and transparent, and most important, very equitable, if I may use the word, equitable in terms of allocation of responsibilities. Third, a leader with all his knowledge and experience has to evolve, in this time especially, a very transparent measurement system of performance and behavior. In the absence of that, you know, as you said, the impediment, it could well give rise to a perception, if not reality, of unfairness, nepotism, overload, underload, and etc., etc. All those negative aspects. The toxicity at workplace largely happens because of perceived unfairness. If you, as a leader, can kill that perception by being very transparent and laying down a very empirical system, I think got a great game going, because you're now no more, if somebody is upset, if it's in the office in the earlier times, you could just walk in and see somebody grumpy or other, what's going on, get a cup of coffee and sort of get it. But now they're all away, they're all virtually working. So you don't know what the state of motivation. And the best way is, and largely people do not like to be advised or counseled, if you will, the best way is lay down an amazing a system which is agnostic of any personal biases, conscious or unconscious. Okay? And the fourth part is, people are really worried, am I going to be rewarded fairly? Because there isn't that personal touch, there isn't that. So what kind of an evaluation system you derive, and how does that evaluation system, the consequence management, manifest in terms of merit increase, bonuses, promotions? Because let's assume this is not just for 2-3 months. Let's say it's extended for 6 months. 6 months in a company's life cycle is 2 quarters. And 2 quarters saying, hey, let it be random, it's very tough. Hey, you're going to lose some good talent. So the talent you want could actually leave you. And the talent who's really not doing could actually stick around with this general comfort level that, hey, these tough times, company's going to lay off. And in some cases, governments have also mandated that, hey, try and see not to sack people or downsize people. That's government job, to give a very altruistic statement. But a business leader, a CEO, has to run based on cost efficiencies and economies of scale. In view of that, clarity of goals converted into roles, measurement system, very important, the way you conduct your appraisal meetings. Until yesterday, you could call me into the room and had that chat, and you could see my eye contact, my body language, my nervousness, my difference. Today it's not there. Maybe it's there, but not as impactful as. So how do you really bring about a very empirical system? And most important, do I end of the day feel, you know what? I didn't get the increase that this guy got, or this girl got, this lady got, but Sharad was very fair as my boss. Ravi as my boss is very fair. I think evolving that amazing stature in a virtual system in the times of litmus test or a stress test becomes extremely important. The second thing which I would like to say is, which by the way, I think I sent you that the flyer. I was just invited by a company in Delhi. They formed, Sharad, their own FM radio system. They got an approval. Every Saturday, the CEO conducts a program on FM for the entire family on the radio. Very interesting. And I was invited as a guest speaker. And it was very interesting. I couldn't see the audience. And exactly the theme that you suggested, positive. He just said, Pramod, just get this up, get these guys to the next orbit. I'm using his word, to the next orbit of motivation, of positivity. Because there is resilience problem, there are family problems, there is a lot of strain and stress. And then the perceived inequality or inequitability of compensation rules, etc. So I think evolving the methodical system, coming across as very transparent, and most important, the killer factor is very, very frequent and open communication. Because perceptions are forming thick and fast. And that's the best time, the best way to sanitize, to insulate anybody carrying any negative emotions is communicate, even by default, maybe over-communicating. So I think these are three, four things by which I would advise, and I'm coaching some CEOs right now because it's the best time to do the coaching via radio or via Skype or Zoom. Can't meet them. And they're all struggling with, Pramod, how do I manage virtual teams? How do I get resilience back? And how do I still keep them motivated? Because if that workforce slithers or sort of dilutes its output, anyway, times are tough. Customers are walking out, business down. On top of it, if you have a very weak fabric or an ecosystem of generating motivation and putting people onto the next orbit of excellence, then you've really got a bad game going. So I think these are three, four things which come to my mind straight away to get people staying motivated. I hope that answers your question, Sharad. Have I covered the, yeah?
Yes.
Because this is the systemic part, yeah. And oh, sorry, one last thing, bringing in attitude. Even our spiritual guide, he says, sitting in meditation or prayer or church, or it won't work if you don't carry an attitude. Building that attitude of receptivity, of openness, of positive contribution is the differentiator between the also ran and the person who tapes the, you know, rests the tape in the race for excellence.
Yeah. Thank you, Pramod. Yeah. I think you brought in some very good points in terms of having this, clarity in goals and this transparent measurement of performance. So I think it's so important because at the end of the day, as business entities, performance is what is rewarded. So having fairness in evaluation, clarity in what you need to do, will actually help in maybe a year down the line. If one needs to evaluate how you actually perform, you need to have some measurable benchmark or measurable yardstick, really. So I think it's extremely important to be able to do that. Otherwise, it becomes full of biases and...
One little point. Off late people are, and I'm sure Ravi would also be employing this whole concept of design thinking. Bringing design thinking to the work processes. Design thinking is most applicable in a virtual environment, which starts with empathy. Do you have empathy for customers? For starters, you as a leader, do you have empathy for your employees? And does that show up? Does that manifest? Empathy, ideation, creation, prototyping, testing, the whole works. So design thinking becomes a great tool, if you will, to manifest these three, four parameters of clarity, transparency, measurement, fairness of awards. I just thought that's it just triggered a thought on design thinking.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. So, I want to put the next question to Ravi. From the perspectives which I have seen, Ravi, I wanted to kind of get into understanding how businesses, as a business entity, can survive in these times. And what should a business entity do to innovate itself? Is there a silver lining in the cloud? How do you know that things are going to turn around, or when will things turn around? So how do people kind of as a leader who's kind of leading and making the business grow? How does one innovate? Some of the statistics which we have been getting is, obviously healthcare industry seems to be doing well and is likely to do well, but e-commerce and some of the other retail industries seem to be doing okay, but there are other industries like travel, tourism, manufacturing, which are kind of badly hit because they seem to be dependent on actual physical force, physical manpower being on the ground. So what do you think should be what should be the thinking, and how should businesses innovate in these times?
Yeah, it's a tough situation, and you know, spare a thought for businesses that don't have the luxury of telling everybody to go work remotely and continuing to stay productive, right? All the industries that you mentioned. Retail is badly hit. Travel and entertainment is badly hit. Several of these companies are going to have a difficult time to recover and come out of this crisis. The average small business tends to not have more than 2-3 months of cash flow that they can rotate around. And those who have not been conservative with their cash flow management and have not, quote unquote, saved for a rainy day, whether it's an individual or a company or a bank or even a government, they are going to find themselves in a bad situation, right? And there's only so much that governments can do to bail people out, and that NGOs can do to bail people out. So it's at some level, especially when it comes to businesses, let's face the truth that some of them will not survive this crisis. Those that do survive will invariably emerge stronger, right? It's the old saying of if it doesn't kill you, it'll make you stronger. This is definitely some crisis. In terms of how to be innovative and what can you do, rethinking business models. For example, we've seen a lot of restaurants, especially in the US, and I'm sure these trends are going to catch on throughout the world, completely pivot to a model where they are offering delivery of meals and, you know, and doing more catering and things like that. Any business, whether you're a dry cleaner, whether you're a, you know, it doesn't matter what type of business you are, everybody's going to have to start thinking about how do I take the product that I have and actually get it home delivered? How do I cover, solve that last mile problem? So that's going to be one. The other is, in some cases, people are looking at the assets they have and seeing if they can totally morph those assets and get into a different game altogether. There are many manufacturing companies that are now producing ventilators, that have started mass producing masks and gowns and, you know, other things, which was not their business earlier. So that's another way to be creative and another way to innovate. There are other ways around financial management, cash flow management, where people are looking at, okay, can I, instead of laying off all the workers, can I do something where we furlough them, or can we take a certain portion of the population to part-time status and manage that way? Anything that people can do to sort of go through this crisis, but on the other side, not come out in a manner where they've lost all their employees, they've lost all their talent, they'll benefit from it. And like anything else, I said, you know, the strong will survive.
Yeah, excellent. Yeah. I think so. Yeah, the strong, the people who kind of go through this crisis and are able to kind of handle their financial cash flow and their business models, if they're able to change their business models, will definitely do better in these times. So I think they're really testing times for business entities. They're good. Yeah. So, Ravi, I just wanted to have another follow-up question for you, which is at a more personal level. How do you bring in that element of fun in how in your in the workplace, you know, so that you retain that positivity?
Yeah, I think it's again right back to the relationships and the you know what we get from the social side. The last couple of days at our workplace, we had a virtual offsite for product strategy. And it's the first time we've ever done something like this virtually, and I thought it was going to be torture sitting on Zoom calls, 10 hours a day for 3 days. And we had our entire C-suite on it. And it actually worked. It was good. It was fun. We were able to get all the creative juices flowing. We used like the breakout rooms that Zoom offers and things like that and made it happen. Second day, there was even a virtual happy hour. You know, those who enjoy alcohol sat with their drinks, and I sat with my chai. And we had a really good time. So I think it's back to that social interaction. A lot of people have started playing Zoom games. You know, we have communities here that are playing Antakshari on Zoom, and you know, there's just all kinds of stuff that's happening. So I think it's the social connection, the interaction, and having fun in a different way.
Mm-hmm. In fact, Sharad, just a thought trigger. A lot of companies who I work with have actually used this lockdown period to do two things. One is they've actually motivated people to tap their talent, singing, guitar, Bharatnatyam, what have you. And there are a lot of courses now on. So a guy until yesterday couldn't play a guitar, he's now suddenly playing a guitar. So as Ravi said, a wonderful opportunity to get that virtual offsite, and there's a talented display. And guess what? For all you know, some guys may carve out a new career after the lockdown. They may become a Bollywood actor, or they may become a singer, or they may become something else, you know. And the other day I was saying, so somebody asked me, what is the one thing you dread out of all this? I have a haircut like what you have right now and what Ravi and you have normal. The one thing I'm dreading is, do I need to now put a ponytail, you know, because I've never been a ponytail guy. Because it's now near death to go to a barber to a salon, right? Because you could just pick up. He touches about 50 people in a day. So I'm already dreading. One of the things I'm uncomfortable is my hair in place, because I've never had this long hair. And if this extends, will I be having a little ponytail here? And suddenly you would not be recognizing, you know? And that's a prospect I'm staring at. Because, I'm just putting the fun element. So some guys would actually go into hair design, as in hair engineering, if you will. They have more fancy terms. So, yeah. Various things to sort of keep it all up the ante. Yeah.
Excellent. Yeah. So Ravi, just is there a social context to the business which needs to be kind of brought in?
Yeah.
So I just wanted to understand, you know, is our businesses looking at making this a better world? And actually emerging as a collective humanity with a positive balance sheet. So being able to kind of help each other, cooperate with each other, instead of cutting each other down. I don't know. I'm just kind of throwing this question up. So how do we make this a better world?
It's the as they say, the $64 million question, right? Let's almost step back a little bit and look at the history of pandemics, because it's very instructive. The last couple of major pandemics, let's not go too far back. In the 14th century, Black Death killed almost 200 million people. And at that time, that was a fourth of the world's population. It wiped out a fourth of the world's population. Europe took 200 years to come back to the same population level. That was the Black Death, right? Humanity was disconnected, superstitious. You know, what did we do with people who got infected? We treated them as untouchables. We persecuted them. We put them in caves. We left them to die. If you look at humanity's behavior during the Black Death, it was deplorable. Anybody who got infected was no longer treated as human. They were treated as subhuman. That's the 14th century. Fast forward, and you look at what happened 100 years ago, which is the Spanish flu. The Spanish flu actually killed, estimates vary, between 50 and 100 million people. And more people than the world wars, right? During the Spanish flu, things were way better. People were treated in hospitals, they were taken care of. It still killed a massive number of people because we didn't have the level of healthcare sophistication that we have today. We didn't have vaccines. We didn't have, at least not to this level. And we didn't have the level of medicines that we have right now, or hospitals, or any of that infrastructure. And come to today's age, every human life is being valued in every country. It doesn't matter whether you're in India, or whether you're in Brazil, or whether you're in the United States. There is this feeling that every life matters. It doesn't matter if you're rich or poor, or if you're, you know, you're a businessman, or if you're a teacher. Every life is being valued. So my perspective on that question, Sharad, is that, and I'd love to hear Pramod's feedback as well.
Sure.
That humanity suffering ennobles humanity. It is happening in front of us. And businesses are nothing else but a collection of individuals. And so businesses are behaving, by and large, there are always exceptions, by and large, they are behaving in a wonderful, responsible, socially responsible manner in spite of suffering severe financial circumstances. We are seeing it happen, and I have no doubt that we'll emerge a better world out of this.
Okay, excellent. Yeah.
Sharad, can I just add to that?
Yes, Pramod.
I think Ravi's brought up wonderful points. The thing I would like to add is, notwithstanding the collateral damages of this COVID-19, whether or not one likes it, voluntarily or involuntarily, this event has brought a degree of spirituality to the whole world, of valuing what you have, of minimalist attitude to life. I mean, look at it. Your posh, fancy cars, your that Armani suit, your Gucci shoes, they're all rotting at home. Where do you go show, or where do you go and sort of exhibit, demonstrate? And today, I think, is a wonderful opportunity that a lot of us have discovered two things. A, we have more than what we need, and we have more than what we deserve, actually. The third thing is, this event has actually brought, you know, there are two concepts you all learned in our basic arithmetic in second and third, highest common factor and lowest common denominator. Right? COVID-19 is the highest common factor, ubiquitous, absolutely ubiquitous throughout the 180-200 countries. Right? Nobody escapes it. The lowest common denominator is most people at least have got to know what is humility, what is large-heartedness, what is sharing, what is camaraderie, what is empathy. You know why I'm saying this? I think, and there are lots of memes and GIFs and everything going around saying how people have started realizing the value of what they have, etc. So I think, I mean, every calamity has the as you said, yeah, when you were asking Ravi, what is the silver lining? Silver lining is, I think people have been now shown what is real godliness. How do you need to respect what you have? How do you need to have humaneness in your approach to life? Because everybody's been brought down to an even keel, down to the knees. Whether it's a king or a Bollywood actor or a cricketer or a sportsman or an NBA person, everybody is now doing their clothes and washing and ironing and mopping and sweeping. So, you know, this leads me to tell you, there are three things which I've read it somewhere. These are not my thoughts, but great thoughts. Three things: no entitlement, no greed, no fear. Amazing stuff. Nobody's entitled to anybody and anything here. You cannot say I come from the legacy of Raja Maharajas. No, everybody, every big guy is now doing the dishes at home. So no entitlement, and no, and this event has caused that. Second is, do not get greedy. Whether it's going to the Walmart or D-Mart and getting your stuff, there's enough for everybody. Just be that little magnanimous, what Stephen Covey calls it, the abundance mentality. And third is, no need to fear. Whether the moment panic sets in, that's the beginning of the end. So to add to what Ravi said, I think there is a huge amount of, and I'm not trying to be esoteric here when I say spirituality, it's really about being centered and being very authentic to another human being, because we're all in it together. If one guy deviates, we're all going down the tube. And that collective cohesive, collective wisdom, if you will, universally, I think is a great, great takeaway which people have learned, albeit they've learned it the hard way. I wish people would have been like this even when times are good. But hard way, the better that this way, at least we have really gotten that germs of, or the grain of spirituality, if you will, of seeped into each one's DNA.
Yeah. Thank you. Come on. Thank you. I think it's, Ravi, as you said, humanity has learned from the pandemic.
Absolutely.
And you're kind of improving over the years. I think we are seeing globally, I think we are seeing a huge amount of connectedness to today. In fact, even the political leadership is looking at world ceasefire kind of thing.
Yeah. Everyone should kind of start to work cooperatively. I think we are looking at better times to come. So there is a lot of hope in the air. So I think we touched upon a lot of stuff. Just to kind of
give a quick summary. So we talked about the body, mind, and soul, how one needs to be able to be heartful, keep ourselves very clear-headed. We talked about the new skills which we can learn in this virtually connected environment. Ravi talked about having a routine and how we need to be alert and aware in maintaining our relationships. We talked about Pramod talked about having a clear idea of the goals and a transparent measurement system in place, being fair in our evaluations. Ravi talked about how businesses are rethinking the business models and looking at last mile delivery to be able to serve customers better. We talked about how there can be a lot of social interaction done in this virtual environment so that we have fun stay calm. We talked about how humanity is kind of turning around and we are seeing a better world today. I think we've covered quite a bit of what we intended to. Before we kind of close the session, Pramod, I just wanted to invite you to share a heartfulness tip which could help us clear our mind, which you spoke about. What can we do so that we have a clear thinking person so that we are kind of heartful and centered in these times?
Yeah.
So guide us through that and then we can wrap up the session.
Okay. Thank you, Sharad. Even in normal circumstances, not just this crisis of COVID-19, on a day-to-day basis, we work in fairly stressed environments. And what happens in environments is voluntarily or involuntarily accumulate a lot of impurities and complexities. What are these impurities and complexities? Feelings of anger, frustration, jealousy, introvertedness, silos, all these are manifesting and playing out. Just because they're not in an office, they're not going away. So the best way to have your body and heart manifest is to keep this guy extremely clean and clear. How do you do that? Easier said than done, but it is easy. And thanks to my spiritual guide, I have been practicing it. And trust me, I'm speaking with a lot of conviction and experience, not some theoretical knowledge. How do you get rid of these impurities and complexities? There is a method. And the method is called cleansing or cleaning of your system, because a lot of toxic stuff, which gets in the relationship issues, feeling of unfairness, perceived or real, stress about shopping, queues, long queues, all this, like we accumulate dust when we go out in a day's work, including when you're working from home, whether or not you accept it, you do accumulate a lot of emotions. I know you do. None of us like to accumulate those emotions, but they happen, of ambiguity, of restlessness, jealousy, and all that kind of stuff, unfairness and awards and this, that, other thing. How do you get rid of this? Well, Sharad and Ravi, what I would like to share is there is a heartfulness method called cleaning. The quintessential aspect of the entire discipline and doctrine of heartfulness. Because if this is not clean, no matter how much grace you receive, it is getting pushed back because this system is clogged. So I have a method which we practice called the cleaning method. And for the listeners here, I'd just like to share in a few minutes just the concept and the process. And if Sharadji gives me some time, we can do a 5-minute proof of concept so that we actually practice it. I know 15 minutes, 20 minutes is what it takes, but that's too long on a webinar. So here's the concept. Concept is like when we come back home, you take a shower and clean yourself up. When your day's most activities are over, let's say around 7:38, with due respect to the travel involved for various people, it's important before you take your dinner and resign for the day or go to sleep or spend your family time, it's important to sort of just de-junk and just clean away. How do you do that? So the concept is dejunking and cleaning. The method is, the process is, you sit in a very comfortable position, preferably at a designated place so that the ecosystem, the ambience is created. And this is where you use your willpower. You give an instruction to the brittle mind that all impurities and complexities, all these toxins and negative emotions, which are coming in the way of you being extremely effective family man and an executive, they're all leaving your system from the back in the form of a vapor or a steam. Trust me, this auto-suggestion, this thought really works. And the key thing is, you've got to be proactive and you've got to use your willpower. It ain't gonna happen on its own. You've got to make an effort. Now, that doesn't mean you pick up episode by episode. You give a general instruction that the general impurities and complexities in the way that the thoughts, negativity, etc., are leaving my system, are leaving my body system, leaving my mind system, my heart system from the backside in the form of a vapor or a steam. You do not have to visualize any vapor or steam. Just be with that thought for about 20, 25 minutes every day around 8, 8:30, depending on your local convenience. The functional concept is when day's most activities are over. So you now do not have anything else except dinner and family time. That's the best time you sort of get rid of all those things. Else, what's going to happen is you're going to carry that toxicity of workplace, pressures, everything into family life. And then it's a vicious circle of catch-22. Because you had a bad day, you're rough with a child who comes to you for homework and says, you brush it away saying, hey, excuse me, my boss has just given me a hard time, the new targets. Now, why do you want to transfer that pressure of office to your child or your spouse or your parent? They don't deserve it. They don't merit it. So it's important you filter that out so that when you're at home in your family ambience, you're really the family man, completely available 100% in your heart, body, mind, soul-wise to the family. And the method is you sit for 25 minutes in a preferably in a fixed place and give a thought. So Sharadji, I don't know how much time we have. If you would like to have a proof of concept for all the listeners here, we can just gently close our eyes. I know it takes 15 minutes, but we can do a miniature 5-minute thing. If you have time, I'll go by you. You're the anchor. You let me know. Otherwise, the concept is cleansing and the process is using mental willpower to sit in a place at the end of the day and just give a thought that leaving your system from way of by way of vapor and smoke.
So let's do a 5-minute thing.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Okay. So if I can request everybody who's on this call to gently close your eyes, sit in a very, very comfortable position, okay? And one precondition is do not chase any thoughts. Let them come and go like uninvited guests. Don't give power to them. If any thought bothers you, just give your mind a thought that, sorry, you're right now busy attending to your cleaning work. Nothing matters. So gently close your eyes, sit in a comfortable position, and give a thought. All impurities, complexities, blockages, which are coming in the way of your being an effective human being and a professional, are leaving your system from the back in the form of vapor or smoke. With this thought, and please use your willpower, and do not chase any particular episode. Just give a generic thought that all the impurities are going away together in the form of vapor and smoke. So with this thought, let us sit for 5 minutes until Sharad comes back and says, that's all.
That's all.
Thank you, Sharad. I'm sure all of you will be have experienced a little bit of lightness. And if I can request you to put this as a 21-day practice of 25 minutes every day in the evening, trust me, you will be very positive, you'll be very productive, to be in line with the theme of the seminar. And it's an amazing technique given by the founders of this heartfulness system, my indebtedness to the spiritual masters.
Thank you, Pramod. Thank you for sharing that tip. If you want to know more about the heartfulness webinars, wellness webinars, you can, and if you have any queries, you can write to this email ID, which is showing up on your screen, wellness@heartfulness.org. We also just wanted to share some more information about heartfulness. So we have several heart spots, which are basically locations where we have trainers available. So we have about 6,000 heart spots, which can connect to about 10,000 trainers across 130 countries. So you can connect to any one of them in your country. And get more information about how to start the practice of meditation and how to continue it, so that you can have all the tools and techniques which are required, which are offered by a heartfulness system of meditation. We also have an application app which works on the Android or and the iPhone phones, which allows you to be able to connect virtually and get a meditation session. So you can use that also, download it from HeartsApp. So there are several videos which are also available, which kind of guide you through this system, which are there on the YouTube channel, Heartfulness YouTube channel. We also have a series of about 3 masterclass sessions, which kind of introduce you into the system of meditation. These have been conducted by our global guide, Sri Kamlesh Patel. So these are also available on our website, heartfulness.org/en/masterclass. Please join these masterclasses and also share it with your family and friends. We have more other resources which are kind of available on our heartfulness website, and you can take benefit of these available resources. So with this, I would like to thank Pramod and Ravi for this excellent session and for having shared their insights, which will help all of us as individuals, as team leaders, as business entities, to be able to kind of come positive and through these circumstances and have a fruitful time. So thank you very much, Pramod and Ravi.
Thank you, Sharad. Thank you, Pramod.
Thank you, Sharad. Thanks, Ravi. And all the very best to everybody. Yeah. Go ahead. Thank you. Only 2 last things. Faith in the higher power and trust in yourself, your home and drive.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you.